I'm going to engage this 1 hour of this training session for just introducing you to the TCP/IP protocol suite. So what we have learned in the morning, we are just talking about some cybersecurity tools. We have discussed about some techniques and all. But now the important thing is what, like how everything that we are going to secure is a network. But we should be aware about like how our network is working, and only we'll be able to understand the tools and all. We should be aware about what are the protocols. We should be aware about which are the layers that are being used for implementing the networks. So now I'm going to discuss about TCP/IP protocol suite. I'll be just taking very short of your time. So as we know that TCP/IP model is the model which is being used in our internet. In internet, when we say that which network architecture we are using TCP/IP protocol suite. So TCP/IP protocol suite, what is it? Actually, if I just want to know how my network is working, then I have to go to a number of details. For example, I hope I'm audible to all also. Yeah. So if I think about like how my network is working, then we should be very much aware about the thing that we are using the computers with our natural languages. Natural languages like our local languages also, English and Hindi. And today, most of the applications are implemented in the form of local languages also. So we are using the computer based on our computable level. So it is just simply like whenever I'm just accessing a website, like I can just change to my native language. So I'm using it as much as I'm comfortable with it. So this is very easy for me to use it. So if I'm an end user, then networks are working very good for me. But how they are working internally? Actually, what I'm sending is in the natural language, but is my computer able to understand that natural language? Definitely not, because my computer processes everything in the form of binary. Then what I have to do? I have to convert my natural language data, end user's natural language data, into binary, and then I will be sending it to a particular set of functions which are to be followed for implementing my networking functionality. So this is the first task that I have to do. I have to convert it into binary form. Then I have to perform a number of other functions. For example, I'm sending movies online. I'm just downloading on-demand movies. I'm just downloading the songs. I'm live streaming of the song. I'm involved in the live streaming of the songs also. Whatever data I'm getting is actually the multimedia data. So this data is of very large amount. So the next thing that I have to do is I have to compress this data also. So this is the thing that I'm performing on my data. But now, when I'm talking about the network means a collection of computing nodes which are communicating with each other. So if they are communicating with each other, then definitely there are some set of functions which are required to be implemented between both of them. For example, the machine should have an identity, only then they will be able to identify each other and they will be able to communicate with each other. Machines are not only communicating, but the processes running on these machines are communicating with each other. So they should also have an identity. Machine is having a local identity, MAC address, which is there, which is analogous to a flat number in a society. So these are different addresses which are required to be understood. I'm able to have www.yahoo.com. I'm not able to remember the IP address of the yahoo.com. So it means that something that I have to do is actually, which is as per my comfortable. If it is not comfortable for me, I will not be using it. So definitely the networks are becoming comfortable to us day by day. That's why we are using it. So just to provide us the comfort, new functionalities are added to the network day by day. So they are having some basic set of functionalities. For example, I have to convert it into the binary. I have to compress it. I have to do what I have to do. I have to add an identification of the machine, sending machine, receiving machine. I have to add the identification of the sending process, receiving process. These many things I have to do. But day by day, new applications are being added. So new functionalities are being added. So what we are doing, actually defining the network as a single set of function, is a very difficult task because it's a very large function. Enabling communication between two machines is not as simple as adding a wire and just defining IP address and MAC address. Enabling communication between two machines require a lot many functions to be implemented before they talk to each other. So that thing is done with the help of a concept that we call network architecture. Network architecture is something which is telling me that what all function I have to perform to enable the communication between two machines. So just to implement that architecture, there are different models. So network architecture is represented by different models, and TCP/IP is one of them. It was originally developed by DoD, Department of Defense, which was earlier known as ARPA, and it was the model that came in 1970s. So 1970s means exactly 51 years before. So this model came at that time, and this was the short and snappy version of OSI model, which was a very detailed model given earlier by ISO, and that was not very much popular due to its generic nature and more detailed given to it. So TCP/IP took the place as a very popular model, and this became the basis of the internet. So this model describes the network communication by dividing the communication procedures into simpler and smaller components. So what we do in a model, we simply just collect all the functions required to implement the network, and we just distribute it among the layers. So depending on different models, the functionality that we encapsulate, we embedded with the layer is changing. For example, in OSI model, we distributed it among 7 layers. In TCP/IP, we did it in 5 layers only. So this is the way how it is being done. So TCP/IP model is nothing but it's a collection of layers, and every layer defines some set of functions. These functions are required to be related to each other. So that we will be talking throughout this hour. So inspiration of network architecture models like TCP/IP have been taken from our postal system that you can see from this diagram. There is a sender, the letter is written, and it is put into an envelope and dropped in a mailbox. Then the letter is carried from the mailbox to a post office, and then the letter is delivered to a carrier by the post office. On the other side, the letter is delivered from the carrier to the post office, the letter is carried from the post office to the mailbox, and the letter is picked up and removed from the envelope and read. So here you can see this is always a step-by-step procedure to send a letter. Okay, here the letter is first written, and then it is delivered. It is delivered to the carrier service. Okay. On the other side, the letter is delivered to the post office by the carrier service, and then it is picked up by the receiver. So here, this is the human or the end user. Here, this is the human or the end user. One is writing, another is receiving. In the intermediate time, you can see that these are the layers, these are the functions which are being performed in between. Okay, so here the post office is delivering, and here the post office is accepting. Here the letter is collected from the mailbox, and here the letter is sent to the mailbox. Here the letter is written, and here the letter is picked up and removed from the envelope. So these are all reverse function of the reverse function on both the sides. Here it is written, here it is read. Here it is carried from the mailbox to post. Here it is carried from post box to mailbox. So this is the set of functions that we are performing while sending a system. Same thing is being followed in our computer network architectures also. One more special feature of this diagram is what? That you can't change the order of these functions, of these. You can't take the letter from mailbox to post office before writing it. Okay. And if you have not delivered it to the post office, then your post office cannot deliver it to the carrier. So there is always a hierarchy of steps here. You are starting from here, you are going to the lowest possible function. And then here, you are starting from this lowest possible function, you are going to the highest possible function. So this is what this is known as a layered architecture, right? Because we have a hierarchical relationship between these steps. Okay, so the same thing is being followed in our network architecture. So in TCP/IP protocol suite, there is a 5-layer TCP/IP protocol suite that we will be talking about. So there are 5 layers defined here. So these 5 layers are representing 5 different functions. So we'll be talking about these functions also. But when I talk about sender, so if it is a sender, then the data will be moving from sender user to the application layer. Application layer will give this data to the transport layer, like the previous diagram. Transport layer will give this to the network layer. Network layer will give it to the data link layer. Data link layer will give it to the physical layer. Then on the receiver side, the physical layer will be delivering it to the carrier. This may be your transmission medium, like your fiber optics or your coaxial cable or your wireless network, whatever we, then on the receiver side, the process will be just reverse. The data will be received by a physical layer. It will then go to data link, then to the network, then to the transport, and then to the application, and application to the receiver. Okay, so this is the way how the transmission takes place using the five layers of TCP/IP protocol suite. So these are five layers of TCP/IP protocol suite. One is the topmost layer is known as the application layer. Then transport layer, host-to-host layer, network internet layer, and then data link layer, and then physical layer. So if let's talk about the application layer. Okay, so application layer is something which is more closer to the user. The user who is using the application layer will be actually, this is the point between the other layers or the complete model or the network and the user. So I'm using the application layer. So application layer will be connecting me and my network. Okay, so this is the topmost layer in TCP model. For what it is responsible for? It is responsible for the services that network is providing to me. So if I am an end user, then I will just expect the services like I can just access the websites, okay, using the internet, the network. I can just access the remote machine in my network. I just perform FTP. I can download a file from YouTube or something. So these are all services that I'm expecting. So application layer does what? Application layer defines the procedures, defines the protocols to perform that particular task. I'm expecting that I should access internet. So to access internet, I need one thing, that is what? Browser. The browser is implemented in application layer. Second thing, what I need a protocol using which I can just access my web servers. So protocols are what? Protocols are just set of rules which are required to be agreed upon between the sender and receiver. So two entities are there always in a network communication. One is sender and the other is receiver. So whenever the sender is willing to communicate with the receiver, then both should have some same set of rules to be followed. Okay, these are known as the protocols. So this application layer defining those protocols for the communication between the client and the server. Okay, client by browser and the server is the Facebook server, your Gmail server, or your whatever, like whatever server you are using. That all are communicating with the help of a protocol that is known as HTTP. So if I say that HTTP is being used between the client and the server, then client should support HTTP. It should use HTTP. Similarly, the server should also use HTTP. So this protocol HTTP is defined on application layer. Okay. Similarly, file transfer FTP. This is required to be implemented by both the sites. Those protocols which are related to the services provided to the user are defined on application layer. Similarly, remote login, if I say Telnet or SSH, you must have heard about SSH also, is to connect to a server using the encrypted way, then I use SSH. So this is defined on application layer. So these all protocols which are directly related to user are defined on the application layer. So apart from that, it is also responsible for some other things, like it is responsible for binary encoding that we were talking about. Whatever natural language I'm using, I'm a user, so I want to interact with the internet for sending my text. I will be just typing this in the Google search box. What my computer will do then, my computer will give it to the application layer, which is a part of my operating system. And that part of my operating system application layer will then convert this natural language text into the binary text. So it's done by this layer. Apart from that, it is doing the compression. If I'm sending a very large file, then reduce the bandwidth consumption, I'll be using compression. So compression is done by this layer. Similarly, encryption. If required, then the data will be encrypted, cryptography will be used, so that is also the part of this layer. So the protocols like HTTPS are working for this purpose. This is the way how it is working. So this is the user who is just giving the data, user, human or program, maybe they are just giving the data, like your Google search, they're having a voice symbol also. So whenever you are just clicking on that, you are just typing the, you are just speaking the things and it is understanding very well. Okay, so this is a program which is taking the user input. That will be giving the input And these are the protocols which will be working for that purpose. For example, I'm searching that Google, you must have understood that it is using HTTPS. It will be using the HTTP protocol. And then this data will be given to the lower layer. So this is the layers are having a function like the superior and the subordinate. The top layer, application layer, will use transport layer as a subordinate, and it will just hand over its data and say, oh, you please take my data and you just forward it to the destination. Now it is not aware about how he will be how this transport layer will be doing it, but still he is giving his own data to this transport layer, and he's this is saying that, okay, you take my data and you please give it to the other side, to the receiver, you please send it to the receiver. Transport layer will very happily take this data from the application layer, and then it will just perform its task as a very good subordinate. So it will take the data, whatever transport application layer is giving to it, and then it will just take this data as a payload, next packet or segment, whatever it has, and then it will add a header. So here you see, this is the FTP, which is the protocol. So this is the layer 5 protocol. This is all processing is being done by the application layer itself. The user is generating some data that will be just taken as a payload. And then this H file, this is the header file. This is some information is written by this application layer over this data. For example, this is your web server. So web server is using, suppose, HTTP protocol. So HTTP protocol, which you are using on the sender side, the same protocol is being used on the receiver side also. So these two protocols, to talk to each other, they need some request and response. So HTTP has some request and some response. So it will be sending a request, it will be sending a response. So the request will have some header information, like what type of text it is carrying. It's a type of, like, it's a text or it's an image or it's some MPEG data. So what type of data it is carrying? So that type of information will be encapsulated using header. So header is something there you are just adding the additional information that is required for the receiver to understand the thing. This is something which is additional you are adding to the data. And on the other side, when this data will be received by the transport layer, okay, then transport layer will do what? Just read this data, H5, this header data it will be reading, and then based on this data, it will be concluding what it has to do. Okay, it will be just handing over this to FTP. Here I am just taking the example of FTP, so it will be giving it to the FTP protocol, and then it will be just adding this to the user. So this is simple, like if it is a client and it is a FTP server, so client sending a request for a particular FTP file. Then this FTP will just establish a connection or just generate a header, and this header will be added to this data, and this header may have the information about what command and responses, what it is doing, like it is sending okay, it is receiving 250 okay. So this type of messages will be delivered. So this header will have some redundant information that will be sent to the receiver side, and receiver will be using that, and then it will be handing it over to the FTP. So the FTP on the receiver side will actually be processing this information, and then it will be just given to the user or the program. So FTP server will be receiving it there. The next layer of TCP/IP protocol suite is the transport layer. This is the layer which is actually dealing with the process-to-process communication. So I just want to show you that how it is working. This is working process-to-process. There is a process on my machine and there is a process on the receiving machine. Then just showing you the process-to-process communication that you can see. So one process here and another process here. So definitely if it is a communication between process to process, and these processes are requiring some identification now. So this is the identification which is there for each process on your machine. That is known as the port number. Without the port number, your application does not communicate with each other. Okay. That is the port number which is running on your machine, and that is the port number which is running on the remote machine. Normally when I'm talking the client server communication, that are using HTTP or you are using FTP or you are using Telnet or you are using any other protocol, they are using the server applications are always using the well-known ports, which are starting from 1 and they are going up to 1024. So the port numbers are well-known for the well-known services, like HTTPS is using 443 and your FTP is using 2021. Two port numbers they are using, one is 2021, one for data communication, another for control communication. Similarly, your HTTP is using 8080 or 80, So these are the well-known applications which are using well-known ports. Okay, so these are the port numbers. Normally for the servers, these are the well-known ports, but yes, the processes are required on each side, an identity that is known as the port number. So what your transport layer does actually, the transport layer adds the source port number and the destination port number. So this is just indicating that on the remote machine that you are going to connect, what is the identity? Just like in your letter, no, you first write the identity of the person. For example, Mr. XYZ, then care of. Then you define the flat number and then you define the society number, right? So this is the identity of the process that is actually communicating with each other. So a browser is communicating with some remote server, then the identity of that application that is running, like suppose HTTP application that is running on your machine and the HTTP application running on the remote machine. So that is the identity. So that is there in the transport layer. Here you see how it takes the data from the application layer. It takes the data from the application layer, divides it among the smaller segments, and then it gives it to the network layer. Like a regular process, application layer will give it to transport layer will give it to network layer. But before giving it to network layer, it will do its own task. That is what? Calculating additional information to be added to the data, which will be used on the peer layer, on the other side by the peer layer, and then it will be used and removed. Okay, so that is the case how it is working. So what transport is doing that you see, in case of TCP/IP protocol suite, it is both connection oriented and connectionless. What is the meaning of connection oriented and connectionless? The layer having it is having two protocols. One is known as TCP, another is known as UDP. So what is the difference between TCP and UDP? TCP is a connection oriented protocol. It's a reliable protocol. It's provides flow control, it provides error control, it provides congestion control. UDP is a protocol which is not connection oriented. It does not provide flow control, it does not provide error control, it does not provide, it provides error control, but it is optional. It does not provide congestion control, it does not provide reliability. Means TCP says I will guarantee deliver your data, UDP says I am not taking any guarantee, I will be sending your data, if it is there, it is reaching, then it's your luck. So UDP is not a guaranteed protocol, but TCP is the protocol which is supporting guaranteed delivery of your data. Okay, you must have seen about FTP, HTTP, they all are using TCP. If you have studied Wireshark or NMAP, etc. in the day, and you must have seen that TCP is there for every HTTP communication. So HTTP and TCP are related to each other. Similarly, FTP is also using TCP. So where do we use TCP? Where do we use UDP? So the applications which are transmitting large amount of information, normally they use TCP, and the applications which are sending small amount of information, they use UDP, because TCP is having one drawback also. It is having all the features of good boy, but it is having a very, very specific disadvantage also. The disadvantage, if you are using it for the small amount of information, then overhead will be much more than the data to be transmitted. Why? Because first you have to set up a connection. Then you have to transfer the data and then you have to release the connection. So during the connection establishment phase, you are sending at least 3 packets. During the connection release phase, you are sending at least 3 packets. So 6 packets you are additionally sending. Okay, so if you have very small data to be transmitted, then there is no need to use TCP, you can go for UDP. Okay, UDP is used in those applications because TCP is a very good protocol. So obviously it is preferred, but UDP is being also used in some applications where we cannot tolerate the delay. For example, if I talk about the voice communication over internet. So in voice communication, these are the interactive type of applications. You want that the user is involved, you know that user is involved, and there UDP is preferred protocol. Why? Because it is not using acknowledgements also. TCP says I'm guaranteed delivering your data. It means that it is just getting acknowledgement also that yes, I have delivered. UDP says I'm trying, but I'm not ensuring. So UDP does not use any acknowledgement also. So UDP is used for the transmission where you need the faster transmission. In the applications where you need the faster transmission, like your video transmission, video on demand, okay? Your audio in demand. In these all the applications, we are using UDP, and TCP is used in the applications where most of the time end user is not involved, like your file transfer protocol, your HTTP, so they are not, they are using TCP only. So this is maybe connection oriented or connection led. TCP and UDP both are there. Passes the data to the network layer and ensures that the pieces all arrive correctly at the other side. This is a very important characteristic of TCP. It is providing you the sequential delivery. Whatever data you are sending will always be delivered in the sequence, but UDP does not ensure it. But yes, UDP is a very good characteristic. That is what complete message will be sent at a time. So there is no need of sequencing also. Depending on the application, you can use TCP or UDP. So transport layer here you provide you both the features, connectionless or connection oriented. Whatever you want, you use your application. Depending on your application, you can use any of them. Similarly, other functions that transport layer is defining, port numbers are defined, as I told you. Flow control between host while data link layer provides flow control for a single link. So it is providing you the flow control between host, one sender and receiver, and then receiver and sender. So there are total four buffers used, one for sending, another for receiving. On one side, another for sending, another for receiving on another side. There are four buffers used, four memory areas used for the purpose of full duplex communication, and it is using flow control. It is also providing you the error control by using a checksum method. You must have seen checksum in the packets of transport layer, and then congestion control. It is also provided by transport layer. Here, as I told you, it will take the data from application layer, divide it, distribute it among the smaller segments, and then it will do what? It will just add header to the data, and then data will be just given to the network layer. On the reverse side, the opposite side, the network layer will be handing over this data to transport layer, and the transport layer will be doing what? It will be just reading this information, the header information, and then it will be just concluding whether to accept this data or not by, because it is providing error control also. If the data is not accepted here, it is having some error in it, then the data retransmission will be requested. So that is also possible. So retransmission will again be requested through the network layer only. Okay, and then it will be handing over it to the application layer. So this was process to process delivery of this one, transport layer. And then the next layer that we have to understand is the network or internet layer. This is the layer which is the third layer of your TCP/IP protocol suite. TCP/IP got its name with two very popular protocols. One was known as the internet protocol, another was known as the transmission control protocol. So internet protocol means your IP and transmission control protocol means TCP. Because it was using these very popularly used protocols, that's why we named it TCP/IP. Now, the TCP was working on the transport layer, and where is IP? IP is working on the network or internet layer. This is known as the internet layer, but it is equivalent to your network layer in OSI model. That's why we sometimes we call it network layer or sometimes we call it internet layer. So you can use the word interchangeably. Here, the networking layer, internet layer, what is the function of this layer? What functionality you actually include in this layer? This layer is required whenever your network is required to communicate with another network. Okay, so this happens when your machine is required to connect to internet. So today when we are using internet, then this is due to this network layer. So this is the layer which allows us to get connected to internet. This is the layer which is responsible for internet working. Its job is to inject IP packet into any network and have them travel independently to the destination. That is the job of network layer. It is a connectionless layer. It is not using connection. Right? Connectionless layer. It is simply in the datagram approach, means the data complete message will be distributed among smaller packets, and then the packets will be moved through multiple routes. The data can be going through multiple routes, and it will be accommodated, it will be just collected on the receiver side and sorted there. That is done for the data transmitted through IP. So this is the connectionless layer. It is having very good function that is known as the routing. Very important function that is known as the routing. Routing is one that you can just understand. Here you see, I have an end system, and this system is sending the information to this intermediate system. Now this is having two routes, one and two. If my destination is F, then this router is required to decide this path, not this. Why? Because this route is only carrying me towards this destination. So this is what, this is known as the routing decision. This is the routing decision which is being done by this router. Okay, so this is the responsibility of your network layer. So the routers are running this routing algorithms, which are just deciding which route to follow for forwarding the data to the destination. So if I just go to the source to destination delivery, then you just see how this works. I have a sender A and I have a receiver F. All these links in between are representing the networks in the path. This is simply like I'm just using Facebook server. Okay, so I'm just accessing a network which is out of my network, out of CDAC network. So now end system is A and the sender is A and the receiver is F. How the communication will take place with the help of network layer? This will just send the information to its next hope, that is B, because this machine is aware, this network or this router is aware about that the Facebook server is not available in CDAC network. So what it will do, it will just send this data to this router B. This is known as the default gateway of your network. This will just send this data to router B, and now B has to decide which link should I follow. Should I follow this link or should I follow this link? So it will just, it is having a routing table. This routing table is having three entries. What are the entries? One is destination, another is the next hope, and then the cost associated with. So based on this destination, there will be a next hope. So if it is Facebook server, then for the Facebook IP, it will have a next hope, and next hope is what? This one. So it will be following this, and then the data will be sent to the Facebook server. How these tables are created? These tables are created based on the routing algorithms that routers are continuously running. These algorithms are known as RIP or OSPF. These two algorithms are mainly used by your routers. So they are just running these algorithms, and then the data moving from one hope to another hope, and then it is reaching to the destination. So how the layers are working in between? The network layer will be handing over the data to data link layer. Please do my work and send this data to the other side. Then it will be giving it to the physical layer, and physical layer will be handing over this data to the transmission medium by converting it into the signal. Then the physical layer will do what? It will just next hope on the router B. Physical layer will read it, perform its function, data link layer, hand it over to data link layer, and data link layer will hand it over to the router, network layer. What the network layer will do, network layer will just read the packet and just see what is the destination of this packet. Based on that destination, it will go through its routing table, and then it will decide the data to be sent to E. Now the data will again go to the data link layer, then to the physical layer, and then again it will go to E. Now E will decide it is required to send it to F. So here the data will be moving to this point. So in this way, the data will be moving from hope to hope. So your router actually works till this layer only. Router does not require to have TCP or application layers. It is just using with this network layer. That's why that routers are the network layer devices. So this layer comprises of that I just discussed. Now I'm going to show you that it is taking the data from transport layer, adding a header here, and then giving it to the data link layer. On the other side, the network layer will be removing it and then using this data to provide to transport layer. So this is the way how the network or internet layer works. If I go to the last layer, that is known as your network access layer. This is the, basically in OSM, there was two layers. One is data link layer, another was physical layer. So in case of TCP IP, they have not more concentrated on this layer. And what they have done, they have just left these two layers on the network designers. For example, my Ethernet, you must be aware about Ethernet, you must be aware about Token Ring, you must be aware about FDDI or wireless LAN networks. So all these network standards having their own physical layer and the data link layer. So OSI TCP/IP model only describes that what these layers should do, but how these layers will be implemented, that thing has been left on the network designers. Okay. So it is only defining these two layers, physical layer and data link layer, and they have just defined like OSI model that what these layers should do. But how they will be done, that is still left on the network designer. So like your Ethernet does it in different way, your FTTK does it in different way, your Wi-Fi does it in different way. So these things are done in different way by the network designer. So here TCP/IP protocol stack has not interfered. So data link layer is responsible for error control, flow control, framing, and medium access control. That is done by Ethernet data link layer. Physical layer, it is responsible for hardware to be used, which topology you will be defining like this. You can just see here, A will be giving the data to data link layer. Data link layer adds header and trailer, which will include the error control related information and give it to physical layer. Physical layer will convert this data into signal and then give it to this physical layer. This physical layer will convert the signal into data, and then this physical layer will give it to data link layer. It will just use this error and flow control information and then give it to network layer if it is acceptable. If there is no error, if there is any error, then it will ask this data link layer to resend the data. So this will only provide network layer error-free data. Once the error-free data is received by network layer, then it will just check for the destination, and then the data will be given to data link layer again. So here again, the error control related information will be collected, will be added to the data, and then it will give it to the physical layer. Physical layer will again be converting the data to the binary, sorry, to the signal, and then it will again be given to the physical layer. So in this way, these two layers will be working their part on hook to fork layer. But your network layer is working between source to destination. You can just see. So this is the how the data link layer is working. So main functions of data link layer is to provide you the error control, hook to fork, flow control, hook to fork, framing, dividing data among smaller parts, and medium access control. If multiple machines are connected to a single shared medium, then how to avoid collisions between them. Examples of data link layer protocols are IEEE 802.2 or TPP, point-to-point protocol. Physical layer is responsible for everything related to your topology. Aapke network ka design kya hona chahiye? Related to your full duplex communication or half duplex communication, data rate, which medium you will be using. You will be using wireless medium, or you will be using fiber optics, or you will be using twisted pair, your telephone wires, or you will be using coaxial cable. Whatever you will be using will be defined. Now, if I talk about the layer-wise protocols of TCP/IP protocol suite, then these are all the layer-wise protocols. In application, and much more are there. These are not the only one, but there are much more protocols which are there in the TCP/IP protocol suite application layer. SMTP is a protocol which is used for simple mail transfer protocol, used in email, FTP for file transfer, HTTP for web surfing, DNS for domain name systems. We will be talking about them. On TCP transport layer, we are having three protocols now. One is SCTP also, which is included. I'll tell you about that also. And then on IP, we are having total five protocols. In network layer, I have total five protocols. One is the original IP. Then ICMP, IGMP, RARP, and ARP. So these are all defined protocols. TCP/IP model is having one drawback also, that it is not very easy to, it is not very flexible to update, basically. You must have heard about, you people are working in government organizations, you must have heard about IPv6. We have taken a long time to move from IPv4 to IPv6. Why? Because of the design of this TCP/IP protocol suite. All protocols are just closely related to each other. If you are making change in any of the protocols, then this is definitely going to change our complete stack. This is the reason why IPv6 has taken a lot of time, because original IP was very much comfortable with all of these protocols, but now IPv6 requires some changes in the protocols itself. That's why we are not moving very smoothly from IPv4 to IPv6. So it is very difficult for this protocol stack to change. So these are all the protocols which have been different. Okay, so we will be talking about them. So if I do the application layer protocols, then application layer is using protocols like HTTP, HTTPS, Telnet, SSH, FTP. If I talk about these protocols, then HTTP, you all people are aware about. Whenever I'm surfing a website, then I just use the HTTP protocol. But nowadays, we are just given an emphasis that we should use HTTPS. Okay, we should use HTTPS. Why we should use HTTPS? Because it's a secure protocol. Now, why it is secure protocol? Because we have included the functionality of a protocol that is known as SSL, and now the new version is known as TLS along with your HTTP. So then it becomes HTTPS. So this is the application layer protocols which are used for the purpose of implementing the security and implementing the applications. Telnet is a protocol which is used for the purpose of remote login. So as we were discussing, the people are using in networks for the purpose of logging into the machines remotely. For example, my administrator will not be willing to come to my machine to change anything or to install some software. So what they will want, they will just ask me to give them control of the remote access, and they will be just sitting there and they will be just performing whatever operation they want to do with my machine. So RTP, Telnet, these are the protocols which are implemented on application layer itself. SSH, when I'm using Telnet, then it allows me to send the data in the plain format. So it is not secure enough. So like HTTP and HTTPS, SSH is a protocol which is used for encryption purpose. Means the data that you are sending is in the encrypted form. So it is more preferred because of its ability to maintain the encrypted connection. And it sets up a secure session over a TCP/IP connection. Then I have FTP, like file transfer protocol, to allow to be transferred between a server and client. Similarly, other like SMTP, this protocol is simple mail transfer protocol. Whenever you are sending a mail, then this protocol is used. FTP file transfer protocol, whenever you are downloading the files from a file server, then you can use FTP. FTP, HTTP, DNS, this is the protocol which is used for the purpose of converting the domain names into IP address. That you know now that I'm using facebook.com, yahoo.com, then this is required to be first converted into IP address, and then I can use it for the accessing the websites, because IP address is required by the IP packet. So DNS is used for that purpose. SNMP is a simple network management protocol which is required to get connected to the different machines in my network, different routers in my network for management purpose. Telnet, as I have already told you. So these are all protocols. Some other are also there which are not listed here. These are the protocols working on application layer. Then I have the transport layer protocols. The transport layer protocols are three protocols that we were talking before also. So it is having two original protocols. One is the transmission control protocol, as we talked about. It is known to provide reliable and error-free communication between end systems. It is connection-oriented protocol and provides the full control and congestion control also. Flow control and congestion control also. So these are all the functions that transmission control protocol TCP is providing. UDP, on the other hand, does not provide any such feature, but it is the go-to protocol if your application does not require reliable transport, as it is very cost effective. Unlike TCP, which is connection-oriented protocol, UDP is connectionless. In our real-time applications, we use UDP. The reason is what? Because real-time applications, like I'm watching a movie. When I'm watching a movie, then delaying between, like, acknowledgements, which are whatever data server is sending to me, it is sending me a movie frame, and after sending me a movie frame, it is just expecting that my machine should send it an acknowledgement, and then it will be sending me another movie frame. So that type of functionality is not acceptable in the interactive applications. So in those applications, we use UDP. So the frames are encapsulated in a UDP datagram, and then it is sent to my machine. It is delivered. Now I am not required to send any acknowledgement. I'll get back another movie frame, another movie frame. So in this way, I'll be just receiving the movie frames one after another, and it will not be incurring any delay in between. So UDP is preferred in these type of situations. But as it is not providing error control, so some movie frames may be lost in between also. So they are being lost. So in that case, they are the movie frames, like videos are distributed among frames, among so many frames that even losing a single frame will not be just perceived with our eyes, and it will be just interpolable. It will be just understood, and it will not be felt by the viewer. So that type of things are there in the real-time transmission, which we do with the help of our UDP. Here we use UDP and TCP when I'm just surfing the internet, or I'm just transferring the files, I'm transferring the video from YouTube, okay, not live streaming, just downloading it on my machine and then just viewing it. So that type of thing can be done with the TCP. Now, what is SCTP? It's a stream control transmission protocol, which very few people are aware about. SCTP is a new reliable protocol. Why it is a new reliable protocol? Why it has been added to this TCP/IP protocol suite? Because your TCP, as I told you, it was developed in 1970s. And then the transmission speeds were of 10 kbps and maximum 10 mbps. Today, when we are working with fiber optics, we are having very fast transmission machines, then we can have the speed up to gbps. Now, when I'm having gbps speed, then my TCP, which was developed, all the features of TCP were as per this one, this speed. Now, when I was working with mbps, it was working okay, but when I have reached to gb, then it is not very easily able to cope up with it, because it is not supporting that higher speeds. So all the applications like IP telephony, if they require very high communication, then they need something which is providing them very fast communication. And that is done with the help of Stream Control Transmission Protocol, SCTP. So all the new very fast communication speed applications will be using SCTP, and it's a new reliable because this is the protocol which has taken the best features from Transmission Control Protocol, TCP, best features from UDP, and some new features of it also. For example, in TCP, there was a single connection. A single pipe was being created between the sender and receiver. But in case of SCTP, we are using a concept of channel in which multiple connections will be created, parallel connections will be created, and parallel connections will be used to transmit the information. So it is more faster than TCP. It is like UDP because it is message oriented in nature. You can send the data within a single SCTP segment. So that is also possible. So this is a very good protocol, which is taking best features of TCP and UDP and will be used for all the future high speed applications. Then we have the network layer. So as we were talking about network layer, it is having a number of other subordinate protocols like IP. So IP is the internet protocol, which is the ultimate carrier. You are sending the data from transport layer. You are sending the data from any of this layer, any of these layers, all the data will be first encapsulated in IP and then it will be sent. So this is the ultimate carrier protocol of your network layer, which is responsible for carrying the data from one host to another host. Then we have some supporting protocols like ICMP, Internet Control Message Protocol. You must have seen the messages like port unreachable or destination unreachable. These type of messages are given by Internet Control Message Protocol. So if you are using IP and you are sending the data to other side, if I goes wrong, then ICMP will take the control and it will send you the message. It will inform you what has gone wrong. So that is the ICMP. ARP is used when you have to deliver the data to a machine inside your network. Then suppose Facebook, I have accessed Facebook and Facebook is responding me. When Facebook is responding me, then my router is required to have my MAC address also. But it is having my IP address only. Then it will use ARP just to get my MAC address. Okay. So that is the case which is ARP is there. ARP is in different versions also, like reverse ARP, proxy ARP, gracious ARP, RARP. These are different type of ARP, but the ultimate job of ARP is to just provide the IP address to MAC address resolution. And then we have the IGN. This is the protocol which is part of your TCP/IP protocol suite, IGMP. This is responsible for group management. Group management means my network is having multiple groups members, like I'm belonging to a particular news group or something. Then I'm having a group membership. So this group membership I'm required to inform to my default gateway so that whenever a message to this particular group will be coming, then it will be informing me about it. It will be sending the message to me. So IGMP actually works inside a network, and within the network, if any machine is willing to, is a member of a group, then it is required to inform to router, and router will also be periodically asking all the machines explicitly that if you belong to any group, then you please inform me. So that whenever it will get a message, then it will just send it to the machines throughout. So whoever is having the group membership, the message will be sent back to that machine only. So this is what, this is the IGMP protocol. Similarly, one is RARP. So RARP is just reverse of ARP. Whenever you have to get an IP address, you are not having an IP address, then RARP was being used. But RARP is, has just become obsolete now. And today we are using DHCP, Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. So DHCP allows us to get an IP address. You must have heard about the IP address. Like if I just go to, just a minute, I'm just showing you. I'm just opening my command prompt, cmd. Here I just want to type IP config. Then you just see IP config all. And this is the IP address of my machine. This is not virtual layer adapter. I'm just going to my machine's IP address. This one is the my machine's IP address here. It will just tell me about DHCP is all is providing actually this information to the machine. Based on the information received from DHCP, all this information is configured, all these settings are configured in my machine. What is the DNS suffix of my machine? Noida.cdec.in. So if I'll be just adding my machine's name. For example, rekhasarko.noida.cdev, and then this will be the nearest name of my machine. Description, the information is there. Physical address of my machine, this is the physical address which is the hardwired in my NIC card. Then DHCP enabled, yes. Auto configuration enabled, yes, because it's a IPv6 enabled machine also. IPv4 address, yes. Subnet mask, this is given. Lease obtained, so these parameters are belonging to DHCP actually. Oh, okay, sir, okay. So these parameters are enlarging these, like I got the lease. This is the IP address that DHCP server has provided to my machine, and it was provided on January 19. Up to which time it is valid? It is Feb 15. Okay, so this lease duration is distributed by administrator to my DHCP server, and this is the duration for which I will get the IP address. After this lease, I may have this IP address, same IP address, or my IP address has been, may be changed. So that is the DHCP server which is providing my machine's dynamic IP address. As you people know that static IP address and dynamic IP address, there may be two types of IP addresses. Static IP addresses are those which are available with our machines. Like if I just go to this one, new connection settings. And here I have the connections, links. I'll just click on it. And then I can just see these are my settings. Okay. Now, if PC device and control of this network is automatically, no problem. This is my machine. So my machine can have the IP address setting. I hope that it is visible to all. So my machine can have a static IP address or dynamic IP address. So static IP address is one which I just hardwired into it. I just use my setting mein jaake aur I'll be just changing new this static IP address or dynamic IP address. So dynamic IP address is provided by DHCP server. It is showing me the IP address of my DHCP server also. This is my default gateway. This is my DHCP server and this is my DNS server. So default gateway, DNS server, proxy, machine, and IP address information. These all are the common information provided by my DHCP server. So this is the, whenever I'm booting my machine, then a request goes to the server. And then the server responds back with an IP proposal, and that proposal is accepted by machine. So this is the lease duration. For this duration, my machine will be using the same IP. And when this lease was about to expire, then a request will be again sent to the DHCP server. If it can provide this IP address to my machine, then it will be okay. Otherwise, the new IP address will be provided to my machine. So that is the way how DHCP is working. That is also part of your networking. So sir, this was all about TCP/IP protocols. Any query related to this? Any question? Just a minute, sir. I'm just coming back to chat window. Chat window. Share the screen. This is the chat. Question is not able to see. Okay. So static IP versus DHCP, which is more secure? Okay. So actually, security doesn't matter here. Static IP versus DHCP. When your machine is having a static IP, means this IP is reserved for your machine. Whenever you are using DHCP, your address may get changed whenever you are just logging into your system. Okay. The only thing that you can understand that if it is a static IP and it is known to someone in the organization, then they can very easily attack your machine. But if it is a DHCP or IP, machine's IP is getting changed each and every time whenever you are booting, then you may just have the more security. So DHCP can be considered to be more secure, but actually this was not meant for the security. This was meant for the IP address assignment, IP address utilization. But yeah.